Joe, I understand you recently had an opportunity to do something that you've, I think has kind of been on your, vision board for a few years. And I thought that maybe today we could talk about that experience a little bit and some of the key takeaways, because, you know, in listening to you and, you know, one of our other colleagues recently went to the same type of training and she was blown away. I kind of just, the selfish part of me just wants to glean all the information that you just went and got. So why don't you tell her, share with everyone, you recently went to NLP training, and you know, what, first off, what is NLP and why was it important that you go? Just kind of share a little bit with our audience.
Yeah, absolutely. So NLP stands for Neurolinguistic Programming, and it's a concept that I've been sort of around for the past several years at Keller Williams, right? A lot of the MAPS coaching and BOLD and a lot of the content that we teach at Keller Williams is foundationally based upon NLP. And so I had heard of a lot of people going to it, and it finally felt like the right time where I'm ready for this for myself and for my own personal growth and development, and I'll be able to use this information to hopefully help others. And so I went to this training through Empowerment Inc. I highly recommend them. It was a 4-day training, $99 for 4 12-hour days. So massive value add. A lot of people wonder why it's so cheap. They do have additional follow-on training that you can choose to take, and that's a little bit more expensive, right? So that there is a bit of a funnel in that sense. But for 4 days, I mean, this training for $99, I can see not only a 10x return on the information, probably a 100x return on the information, if not more, because it's so powerful.
Crazy. So it all revolves around the mind and brain and behavior. So first question for you is, I think a big piece of the training, if I'm not mistaken, is the unconscious mind. Tell us about that. Like, what does that mean? What is the unconscious mind?
So to understand NLP, what we're really talking about here is the way that you communicate with yourselves and others, right? The way that you communicate with yourself internally and the way that you communicate with other people externally. And so right away, hopefully you can see the connection to your ability to have better relationships, your ability to be better at sales, your ability to help serve your customers at a higher level through this communication. It's very day-to-day. It's not just a business concept. And so we talk about the unconscious mind, and this is where the programming piece comes in. And for the first time, David, I truly experienced on a firsthand level the power of the unconscious. I'd always heard that we use, you know, 5% of our brain, 10% of our brain. Well, that's actually not entirely true. We use 100% of our brain, okay, but only 5% of it is conscious thought, which means that 95% of our brain is unconscious thought. It's all the stuff that's happening in the background that we're not even aware of. So a few of those things would be, first and foremost, the function of our body, right? Breathing, digestion. We don't think about these things. They just happen, right? We talk about all of our memories are stored in our unconscious. You ever have an experience or you hear a word or somebody says something and all of a sudden it brings you back to an old memory, or you think about something?
Is that like sometimes for me, I like catch a scent of something.
Yeah.
Is that that what we're
so
talking
it could,
about?
It could be applied to any of our five senses, right? You could see it, hear it, feel it, touch it, or hear it. And so all of the five senses are part of this. And so, yes, absolutely. Smell would be, certain foods, you smell it and you immediately go back to grandma's house when you were 8,
yep,
or whatever the case is. And so the unconscious is responsible for storing memories. It also controls and maintains all of our perceptions, the way that we experience the outside world, the meanings that we assign to the experiences that we have. So for example, I'm driving down the road and somebody cuts me off. If I've been cut off in the past, and depending on the state I'm in right now in this particular moment, is going to heavily impact the way I react to that stimulus. So either I go one end of the spectrum, this guy's a jerk, he just cut me off, I can't believe it, and I start freaking out and feeling the emotions change inside my body, or the meaning I assign to it is, well, this guy's clearly in a rush, he's in a bigger rush than I am, I'm going to give him some space, give him some grace, and move on with my day.
So when you're talking about this, it's interesting to me. I was just listening to another podcast with an author, John Acuff. I don't know if any of our listeners have heard of him, but he just recently wrote a book called Soundtracks, which I think is a lot of this similar information. And he was sharing how, like, when you gain an additional piece of information, like when you're in traffic, you're programmed to think one thing, and then if our brain gets an additional piece of information, such as there's a bleeding body in the back of his seat that he's rushing to the hospital, it completely reconditions our, like, response to that stimuli.
Right.
Which I also thought was kind of interesting, but I don't mean to take us down a rabbit trail.
No, that's a perfect example. And the way to kind of summarize this concept is perception is our interpretation. We perceive things to be, and we create a world that we live in based on our interpretation of those experiences. And our interpretation includes those internal representations that I mentioned, past experiences, good or bad. It also includes the current state that we're in. State that we're in is simply a combination of our emotion and our physiology. So we've heard before, motion creates emotion. There's a direct link in human beings between the way that we use our body and the way that we feel. So for example, we've probably heard this before. If I were to ask you, David, show me how a depressed person sits. What do you do? Like, what do you, how do you sit when you feel like crap?
I slump forward. You know, my back is arched.
Right.
I am disinterested. I'm maybe folding my arms.
Yeah. Breathing a little more shallow, right? All these different indicators. Now, if I were to say, sit like you sit after winning the championship game or landing a big recruit or whatever the case is.
Yeah. I'm sitting up straight. I'm proud. I have more controlled breathing, I would say. I definitely have a smile.
And so in this example, our emotion is having a direct impact on our physiology. It works the other way around. If you're in a crap state and you realize it and you want to make a change, get up and move your body. Stretch, breathe really big. And I'll make this quick connection. A lot of people that are smokers, right? What is it that they enjoy about smoking? In a lot of cases, it's just the ability of removing themselves from their current stimulus and going and taking slow, deep breaths. Now, granted, they're breathing in smoke, so obviously not a good thing, but they're changing their physiology as a way to change their emotional state.
A very interesting example.
So it's right. So it's not good or bad. It's not right or wrong. It's you've got to look at it in context and say, am I using this information in a productive way or in an unproductive way?
Very interesting.
Let me give you another quick example that just came to mind. Have you ever heard of people eating away their emotions?
Yeah.
Or eating when they're not hungry. Well, why do we do that? Why at 9 p.m., after I've had a full meal, do I choose to go eat a whole bunch of junk food?
Usually because I'm bored.
It's because I'm bored, or I'm looking for a way to change the way I feel, and so I ingest this sugar content as a way to change my physiology, hoping that it changes my emotional state.
Interesting, yeah.
And so we have all these little patterns that we're exhibiting and all these behaviors that we're experiencing. And honestly, I feel like before this past training, I was a pretty self-aware person. This NLP concept has taken self-awareness to a whole different level for me.
It's very interesting because, I'd even say I definitely believe that there's this connection because, you know, you've heard me say it before, we're whole people. Like, we can't compartmentalize things into buckets, at least not well or over an extended period of time. But just taking just a more active approach to thinking about these examples that you bring up just proves it.
Yeah. And you know, one thing Stephen Covey says is between stimulus and response is our ability to choose. And so let's talk about that. Let's break that down a little bit. So you have this external stimulus, and then you have the end result, which is going to be your behavior, your reaction, right? In between is your right to choose. But let's break that part down a little bit. Because when we say it's your right to choose, well, if it was just a logical decision, do I choose to feel really angry or do I choose to feel okay about this? Everybody would say, well, I would choose to feel okay about this. I don't want to feel angry. But what we have to understand is our unconscious controls our emotions, and our unconscious assigns a representation to that experience. So we automatically, through our unconscious, can sometimes become reactive to the external stimulus. And we do this through distortions and deletions and generalizations. So let me just kind of break those down. Simplicity. A generalization is grouping things together. Now, this can work in a very productive way. Instead of seeing every fiber on the carpet, I just see a carpet, right? This can also work in a less productive way, generalizing, well, everybody thinks that I'm not good enough, or nobody wants to work with me. Well, nobody? What do you mean nobody?
Yeah, those 100% words.
Like 100, yeah. Right, 100% words, exactly. That would be generalization. Deletion. This is not experiencing something right in front of you. Have you ever been looking for your keys and the whole time they've been sitting on the table in front of you and you've been looking around like crazy, or your mom or your wife sends you into the kitchen to get the sugar and you open the cabinet and you can't find the sugar? And then she comes over and it's like, David, it's right in front. It's right there.
If Jamie ever walks away from me, that will be why right there.
Right. Why is that happening? Even though our eyes are seeing it, our conscious brain is not interpreting it. And so we automatically delete. Now, it's important to note on this, deletion has to happen. In any given moment, there are 2 million bits of information that you are experiencing or could be experiencing. So this is everything from the way you, what you see, the movement, the lights, the color, to the way you feel, to what you hear, the sounds, the things that you smell. Like, let me ask you a question. Do you feel the way that your butt is connecting to that chair right now?
Not until you just said that.
Not until I just said it.
Exactly.
Because our brain is only interpreting consciously 126 bits out of 2 million.
Mm.
So the objective is not to experience more bits of information. You would drive yourself nuts.
I'd explode.
You would explode. And it's impossible, right? The human brain is the human brain. And at the same time, how can we be more proactive in making sure that we're observing in experiencing the right 126 bits.
Wow, that's very interesting. That's almost tweetable. How do I experience the right 126 bits? Okay, so there's generalization, there's deletion, and distortion.
Distortion's the big one.
Okay.
This is an alteration of reality based on our interpretation.
Okay.
So I'm at a listing appointment and they break eye contact with me. It must mean they don't like me. That's a distortion of reality. I'm assigning a meaning to it that I don't actually know. And there's some things that we distort that, like, most people be like, well, yeah, like, reasonably speaking, if they roll their eyes, then they're probably not enjoying the conversation. And at the same time, do we actually know that to be true? What we do is we take that information, that external stimulus, and we create a meaning to it, and then we react or behave in accordance with our interpretation of somebody else's actions.
Yeah, man, and this is a big one because this is what we do all the time. I'm thinking about my own life. This morning I received a text message that had a word in it, and I found myself spending just a few too many minutes trying to process that and probably distorting it.
Right. Right. And you start assigning your own meaning, which of course changes your behavior and your response, which then of course has this whole domino effect. We do this all the time. And so I encourage you, just as David and I are talking about this right now, look for the ways that you generalize and distort information in your reality. Look for the meanings you assign to things that you don't actually know to be true, that you assume to be true based on your own internal beliefs. It's a projection.
Yeah. Wow. Okay. So that whole conversation is pretty incredible. And I can see how it starts to impact daily things that we encounter in life and business, but not just business, as you already said. This is just human relationship in general.
Of course. And communication. Absolutely. And so what we have to understand, and to kind of tie this concept up in a bow to move on, is our unconscious mind makes our beliefs a reality, not the other way around. Our unconscious mind makes our beliefs a reality. That guy cut me off because he is a jerk. I just assigned a meaning and made my reality that guy's a jerk, versus that guy cut me off because he's in a rush. I'm going to let him get to where he's going. That becomes my reality. And that becomes my response to the reality. Another way of saying that would be the words we use do not describe the world we live in, they create it. And going back to the jobs of the unconscious, our unconscious follows orders. Our unconscious follows our own orders. And so the words we use to describe our world are what creates that world. For example, if I'm telling myself I know that nobody wants to work with me, how successful is my lead generation going to be?
It's going to be awful.
It's not going to work. And like, we understand that from like a logical perspective, but are we modifying our state and changing our internal representation of events before we go into lead generation, in our perspective and our interpretation of reality in lead generation, such that we can have a more productive and more enjoyable experience with the activity?
Man, and I've got to imagine that if I'm an agent out there, this is something, just that lead generation topic right there is something that happens every single day.
Yes, we absolutely do.
So let's talk a little bit about words then. You've been talking about senses and human relationship and you know physiology, how they interact. I mean, talk to me a little bit about words, the words that we're using, you know, to ourselves and others.
Yeah, so words are a part of rapport. When we talk about building rapport with people, that is human connection. And in order to get a sale, a certain level of rapport needs to exist. More importantly, in order to have a relationship with another human being, a certain level of rapport has to exist. Rapport is just commonality. We like people who are like us.
Right.
So if you and I both have the same sports team, high five, go Patriots, right?
Exactly.
If I was in a different state and I hear somebody say the word Arizona and I'm over in Texas, I'm like, oh, I'm from Arizona. I like that guy. I connect with him right away. So we make these really like subtle connections with people just based on them being like us or our perception of them being like us.
And this happens every single day as well. We were just in the hallway a couple days ago and I was bringing through an agent who's about to join our company. He met someone from Chicago and he said, White Sox or Cubs? And unfortunately, the person on our team said Cubs, and he was a White Sox guy, right. And there was a little bit of tension.
Yeah.
And we joke about it, and yet, right, we're looking for commonality.
Right. And I would go so far as to say the fact that they had a connection around Chicago might have created the rapport, and then the sports team may have broken the rapport.
Exactly.
So it goes both ways. So thinking about the words are 7% of our communication. And there are a few things I want to touch on with words real quick. First of all, the word but negates, the word and moves toward. And we all know that from a fundamental level. And what I want to say is there's not a right or a wrong. It's a matter of context. So let me give you an example. The word but, in my opinion, doesn't need to be removed from our vocabulary. We just need to be conscious about the way that we're using it. So for example, I love him, but he drives me crazy. What's my feeling toward this person, David? What is your interpretation of my feeling when I say I love him, but he drives me crazy?
Right. He drives me crazy becomes the predominant piece of that phrase.
Right. Versus he drives me crazy, but I love him. And so it totally changes the structure of the sentence. The words that we use are identical,
Yep. But
the way that we structure the sentence has a big impact on its meaning.
Yeah. Yeah, well, and you said you introduced those words and or but. I mean, if we said I love him and he drives me crazy, or he drives me crazy and I love him, that changes it as well, because it combines the two ideas rather than putting them almost at odds, I would say.
Yeah, that's exactly right. That's a perfect connection. I'm glad you saw that before we even got there. So that's exactly right.
Oh, win column for me.
The words we use matter. And so we want to be conscious of our words and, more importantly, the word structure. Now, tonality is 38% of rapport. This is our tone, our tempo, our volume, the quality of our voice. And along with tonality is upswings and downswings. Right. So we understand basic mirroring and matching. If I'm on a listing presentation with, I'll go ahead and generalize and say that somebody from the South who typically has a much slower cadence and a slower tempo to their mm-hmm. speaking, if I go in there speaking the rate at which I'm speaking right now, that's going to break rapport.
Yeah.
They're not going to feel like they're like me. And so we speak differently. We're speaking two different languages practically. So what do I do to mirror and match? I slow down a little bit. I speak a little bit slower. I don't change who I am. I just change the way that I'm delivering it so that they can understand what I'm trying to say more effectively.
Right.
And create that rapport. Upswings and downswings. So an upswing is obviously a question. Do you know what I mean? Upswing.
Yep.
Downswing obviously is more of a command. Sign today. And so the way we use our language matters. Now, this is fairly obvious, and we need to be sure not to use it in the wrong way. So somebody says, I'm going to list my house for $500,000. $500,000? Upswing creates a question. Now the person's immediately questioning whether or not that's what
they should be doing.
They should be doing or not.
Yep.
And so it has its places, right? Again, it's not right or wrong. It's, are you using it the right, in the right context?
Right. Right.
That you, to make the point that you want to be more effective in your communication.
And do you think we underestimate the tonality piece of this? I mean, you've already said words are 7%. Tonality is what? 38%?
38%.
Do you think we underestimate that?
100%.
Yeah. I see what you did there.
I absolutely do. And so to get to 100% physiology, 55% of our communication. This is obviously just not only the way that we're sitting in our body language, but our posture, our gestures, our facial expressions, the way that we're breathing, blinking, the proximity to each other. You ever have a person get real close to you and invade your personal space a little bit?
Oh, all the time. And you do it a lot.
Yeah, well, that's right. Absolutely. And then you have other people who, when you go to talk to them, kind of open up their body and create less of a direct contact. So being able to read people's unconscious reaction to proximity helps you maintain rapport by not invading their space.
Oh man, this just has me thinking about the people that just don't get that.
Right, right. Exactly, it's true. So that's rapport in a nutshell. Tone, or words, tonality, and physiology.
Yeah, and so really I think the primary takeaway there that you should leave with is really this idea that your words, while they're important, they're actually, you know, very much in the minority as far as if I'm having a face-to-face, my tonality and my physiology really carry the meaning of that conversation, at least in the mind of my listener.
Yeah, absolutely. And what we need to be careful to do is to not assign a meaning to a shift or to a change in what we're seeing. So for example, if I notice that your breathing changes, your body language changes, where your eyes are focused changes, I can sense that there's a change, but what I don't want to do is install my own projection on the meaning of that change.
Very interesting.
Rather, what I want to do is elicit an answer from the person as to what that change meant. So I'm not going to
give me an example.
So I'm not going to say David looked away for a moment, therefore he must not like me. I'm going to say what are you experiencing right now? What are you thinking right now? What's going on? How are you interpreting this information? I'm going to solicit information by asking for further clarification. I'm not going to presume to assign my own meaning to the change.
Okay, so what you're saying is when I sense a shift, whether in emotion, physiology, tonality, speed, anything of that nature, my first response ought to be a question to draw out of that person what that shift actually meant. Is that fair?
100% correct. The alternative is we install and project our own meaning to it, which then changes our behavior and the next course of actions because of an assumption we made that isn't even right.
Well, and isn't it interesting how when you do this, it actually sets in motion a domino effect. Mm-hmm. Because then when I make that next shift, I mean, I'm across the table from you, you're going to start assuming, making assumptions and trying to project your own meaning on what my shift meant. And
right.
Then we end
right.
up so far off course.
Right.
Okay. Interesting.
That's exactly right. It's all connected. It all just begins to domino and it can domino in a very productive way or a very unproductive way if you're not careful.
Totally.
And so I know that this was a lot of content. There's a ton more that we're going to unpack and start to incorporate in different segments. But I at least wanted to kind of give a high-level overview today. So I appreciate you asking those questions. And hopefully this will just bring, if nothing else, a little bit more awareness to people. I'm willing to bet as you listen to this episode today, as you go throughout the rest of your day, you're going to start picking up on, you're going to start sensing little bits and pieces of what we just talked about. And you're just going to recognize it. And you're going to be like, oh, look, David just made a generalization, or oh look, I just made a distortion, or you know, whatever the case is. And so the very first step, as always, is just to notice the pattern, is to be aware of the reaction so that then you can begin to create change.
Yeah, totally. Guys, I hope you enjoyed this conversation with Joe and I. As always, go play All In.
Hey guys, thanks for listening to this episode of the All In Podcast. We want to invite you to find all of today's resources from our show page at aipodcast.co. We also ask that you take just 1 minute to leave us a review on iTunes or wherever you get your podcast. This is how we grow and how we're able to bring you the best content each and every week. Now go play All In.